181, Take Thou My Hand, O Father. We will sing that. Be seated. We want to begin with portions of one of Lefty's favorite psalms, Psalm 71. In you, O Lord, I have taken refuge. Let me never be put to shame. Rescue me and deliver me in your righteousness. Turn your ear to me and save me. Be my rock, my refuge, to which I can always give. To which I can always go. Give the command and save me, for you are my rock and fortress. Deliver me, O my God, from the hand of the wicked, from the grasp of the evil and cruel men. For you have been my hope, O sovereign Lord, my confidence since my youth. From birth I have relied upon you. Quickly come, Lord, help me. And then continuing the latter part of that same psalm, the psalmist makes it clear that he wishes to desire that same assurance and trust in God on to the next generation. But as for me, I will always have hope. I will always praise you more and more. My mouth will tell of your righteousness and of your salvation although I have not its measure. I will come and proclaim your mighty works and acts, O sovereign Lord. I will proclaim your righteousness, yours alone. Since my youth, O God, you have taught me, and to this day I declare your marvelous deeds. Even when I am old and gray, Do not forsake me, O God, till I have declared your power to the next generation. May your might be to all who are to come. Welcome for coming. We welcome each of you who have shown the support to this family, not only today, but in the months and weeks that have passed. And on behalf of the family, we want to express your appreciation for being here. Lefty loved people, and he would enjoy seeing this group of people here today. On behalf of the family, you are invited to remain following the services for a time of refreshment in the fellowship hall. If you can stay, please consider that. Let us bow in invocation prayer. Lord, we give you thanks for Lefty, for his life, for his years amongst us. In this season of Thanksgiving, we do gather with thanks. We can call upon you as our Lord and Redeemer. We invite the presence of your Holy Spirit into our midst. May that Holy Spirit comfort in our seasons of saying goodbye. Together with the psalmist, we confess that the Lord is both a rock and a fortress, to whom which we can always go. In the shadow of that rock, you visit us with your salvation, and you displace our fear, our anxiety, with hope and power of the resurrection. Calm our hearts. May what is said and shared here today bring honor and glory to our Savior, Christ Jesus. We are comforted to know that if your eye is on the sparrow, surely it is also upon us who are your children. Amen. This time, we will be having a special music.
Oh, I will be reading 2 Corinthians 1, 2 through 5 from the Living Bible. May God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ mightily bless each one of you and give you peace. What a wonderful God we have. He is the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the source of every mercy, and comforts and strengthens us in our hardships and trials. And why does he do this? So that when others are troubled, needing our sympathy and encouragement, we can pass on to them this same help and comfort God has given us. You can be sure that the more we undergo sufferings for Christ, the more he will shower us with his comfort and encouragement.
Thank you. That was special. There will be a video, I believe, at this time. Am I correct? And during that time, while you're watching the video, you are to be thinking about if you want to share. There is a brief time of sharing. One of the family members will be sharing also, but there will be an opportunity. The mic will be brought to you if you want to share at that time. So, is the video ready?
Hi, I'm Garrett, Deb and Don's son, and when I think about Grandpa, I think my favorite memories would have to include definitely fishing. He took us out a lot. I remember going pan fishing, things like that, which was always a lot of fun to get to do that. And I think my fondest memory would have to be just kind of sitting around in the evenings at their house. He used to always make popcorn, and it was always, I don't know what he did to that popcorn, but that was fantastic popcorn. And the other thing that he used to always make, which was delicious, was orange juice and Sprite. So when you're, you know, 5 or 6 years old, there's not much better than that. So if I have to think about why I'm his favorite grandchild, you know, who doesn't enjoy relaxing at the end of the day? So that would definitely be part of it. So, all right, miss you, Grandpa. Bye.
Hi, I'm Jennifer, the daughter of Dean and Cindy. Living in Indiana, I got to see Grandpa a few times a year, and whether we would go out to South Dakota or Grandma and Grandpa would be visiting Indiana, one thing was for sure, and that was most evenings would be spent playing games, usually Pegs and Jokers. And one of my favorite parts of playing games with, especially Grandpa, was he would sit there very quietly playing, taking his turns, and then all of a sudden would have the perfectly timed comment or kind of trash talk towards the other team. And that was just so much fun to play and see him like that. Which also goes along with probably why I was a favorite grandchild, and that would have just been, I think I was the favorite grandchild because Grandpa and I shared such a love for playing games and just look forward to that every time that we would have been together.
Hi, I'm Darcy, and I am the daughter of Deb and Don Beyer. Some of my favorite memories that I have with my Grandpa Ries was when we used to kind of drive down through the river hills and out by the river and some of the different lakes, and we would look for different birds and animals in nature. Grandpa loved birds. He could tell you about any type of bird there was, spot it, and then tell us what it was called. Some other memories that I have with my Grandpa were playing lots of games. He loved board games. Pegs and Jokers was one that always stuck out to me that he loved to play with us, and just different card games as well. He loved Pinochle, but I never learned how to play, so always kind of had to sit that out. But the board games was always fun to play with Grandpa. And another memory that I had when we would go to Grandma and Grandpa's house was eating popcorn and drinking orange juice with Sprite. So that was always a treat that we used to get anytime that we would go over there. Also, another thing that he loved was telling jokes. His wit just was really funny. He would randomly just kind of throw out a joke or a little comment that would just make all of us laugh.
Hi, I'm Dustin Cressman, Jamie and Karen's son. One of my favorite memories with Grandpa is going fishing. I remember going out to South Dakota in the summers and spending time fishing with him, specifically fishing with stink bait, stuff that I did not want to touch, but he would just continue to bait the hooks for me, and we just enjoyed time outside together. Another memory I have is, and something that I admire him for, is that through all of his strokes and diabetes and medical issues that he dealt with for many, many years, I never once heard him complain. He just went about each day and had a positive attitude, and that's something that I'll never forget.
I'm Chris. I'm Bob and Cheryl's son. I will always remember the fishing trips that we went on, especially the ones to Chamberlain. I always had a really good time, and I know he really enjoyed them too. Another thing that I'll always remember is all the family gatherings that we had. You know, sometimes there were up to 30 of us sitting there, and he was always just listening to the conversations, and before you know it, he'd hop in there with just a comment that was one of the funniest things that for the situation. I'll never forget sitting in Wisconsin around the campfire, and he said something, and there were tears just streaming down his face. He had some pretty good timing, and he was really funny. And I'll miss him a lot. Love you, Grandpa.
I was so fortunate to have seen my grandparents almost every day growing up. I'd often spend the night at their house when I was younger, pretty much weekly, and I loved it. We'd always watch the 10 o'clock news, have popcorn, have a concoction of either grape or orange juice with 7-Up or Sprite. And then in the morning, Grandpa would usually be the one making breakfast, a lot of times pancakes, and we'd have half a grapefruit. I remember one day I did not want to go to school the next day, and before we took my temperature, I decided to hold it under some hot water to hopefully help my case of being sick. Well, they did not buy that. I was a little too sick and had to go to school. Around middle and high school, I spent a lot of my summers traveling around the country with Grandma and Grandpa Ries going to gift shows. I remember one particular trip, we were headed to Dallas and we were in somewhere in Oklahoma. Grandma was driving, Grandpa was resting in the back, and it was starting to storm, and I remember seeing this line and saying, that's so weird, it's like raining in a straight line over there. Well, after a couple minutes, it became pretty evident that that was not a straight line of rain, that was a tornado. So I thought we should stop, we should get in the ditch, and Grandpa's in the back yelling at Grandma, just keep driving, drive faster. Well, we made it out just fine, and that still to this day is the only time I've seen a tornado in person. Later in college and after college, I enjoyed several trips to Texas to visit Grandma and Grandpa while they were there in the winters, both by myself and also with my parents, and Simon came along on one trip as well. So we always had lots of fun adventures together, and I'm just so thankful that we got to spend so many years with Grandpa Ries, and thankful that my kids got to meet their great-grandpa and get to know him, and we're gonna miss him so much, but we know that we'll see him again someday, so that gives us hope.
Hi, I'm Ashton. I would have to say that one of my favorite memories with Grandpa would be making flower deliveries with him as my co-pilot. One summer, I flew out to help Cheryl in the flower shop, and Grandpa and I were making flower deliveries near Menno, and there was a really bad storm coming, and I could tell that Grandpa was getting nervous and that we needed to get back to the flower shop as soon as we could. And I was coming up to a stop sign, and he told me that there are no cars coming and just to keep driving. He also told me to get back to the flower shop as fast as I could, but to get us back safely. And he also told me that I could never tell Grandma. Sorry, I told our secret, Grandpa.
Hi, I'm Mitch Wallman, the son of Bob and Cheryl, and Lefty was my grandpa. I was his favorite grandchild. Coincidentally, he was also my favorite grandpa, but for a couple of reasons. Number one was because he attended my sporting events and loved coming to baseball games. He always wanted to know what was going on with the team. I'm certain that he came to more events of mine than any other grandchild. I played baseball in the Black Sox until I was like 36 years old. He made almost every single home game, and he enjoyed them immensely. I'm also his favorite grandchild because I'm the only one to take him to Texas to and from several times. I also know that he felt safest when I was at the helm of the wheel, driving them down there. We had great times eating at restaurants, just getting them set up in the trailer, playing pegs and jokers with all the old fogies, and he loved doing that, and it was great to be a part of it. We also had good times in Chamberlain. My dad is the one responsible for a fishing trip that we took several times where we would limit out on walleyes. And I can just tell Grandpa was having the time of his life with me, my dad, and Chris fishing on the river. And also, our times in Wisconsin, Grandpa was never happier than when all of the families from South Dakota and Indiana would get together and go take a trip to Wisconsin. And then also, I just know how he enjoyed watching all of the families grow and add new people to them, new grandchildren, new wives and girlfriends and such. Grandpa was just as happy as could be when all of the family was together. And the last reason that I know that I was Grandpa's favorite grandchild is I'm pretty sure he's the only one that left $500 straight cash in his will. So thanks, Grandpa, for making it rain. Benjamins!
Some of my favorite memories of Grandpa have to be the many road trips back and forth to Chicago on the floor of the old brown van, or the many unique gifts and gadgets he'd find at a random roadside store. But probably the memory that I'll remember the most is his love for the simple things. As I would talk with him later in life, you could see his face light up as he would tell me about the newest bird at his bird feeder, or see his eyes light up when he would tell me how the local baseball team was doing. This was evident as I would drive around with him, as he would quietly sit in the passenger seat, absorbing, taking in all the wonders that the earth had to offer that day. And then out of nowhere, piping up, "Look at those trees over there. How beautiful those leaves are." Or, "Look at that sunset setting over that pond. Isn't that neat?" He really did love the simple things in life. Taking in everything he saw and seeing the beauty in all of it. What a great reminder to me to slow down, enjoy the ride, and see the blessings in every day. Thanks, Grandpa.
Start off the sharing. One of my earliest memories of my grandpa was when I was younger at Fensel's. If you knew how us kids grew up at Fensel's, it was a free for all, and you could pretty much do whatever it is that you wanted to with no parental supervision. But like the earliest thing that I remember was with my cousin Garrett and my brother Chris, one of the things that we liked to do was go put our swimming trunks on and play pigs in the mud. So we would go to the back and find a place where, if it had rained, we'd go play pigs in the mud and throw mud at each other and just get filthy dirty. Well, one of the times, Grandma and Grandpa had just got in a brand new, like, whirlpool hot bathtub with the jets on and stuff, which they have at the back of their house, and we thought it would be a good idea to go clean off in the new bathtub. So we went in there as filthy as could be, traipsed mud throughout the entire house, took our bath and went out, and Grandpa found us in the garden center, and he was not happy, and he decided to give me my first spanking from him, and only spanking from him. And I don't know if he was more mad after the spanking because I laughed and I ran away, and he could not catch me to give me another one. I also know that my mom didn't learn to give spankings from him because I cried after all of hers, but anyway, and then one other thing that I just love about my grandpa was I have told him hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of jokes. And the last one I got to tell him, this was right before he died, I'll share it with all of you, is how do cats like their steak? Medium rare.
Me to bring the mic to them when I get it going, just raise your hand.
My name is Julie Anderson, and 10 short days after Cheryl married my uncle Bob, my dad passed away suddenly at the early age of 42, and since then we have pretty much become family to the Rieses, which I am so grateful for. I'm not sure the reason, but one of those trips Mitch couldn't make down to Texas to bring Lefty and Joanne back, so I was fortunate enough to fly down, spend some time with them, and pack them up and bring them back. And when Lefty learned that I hadn't ever seen a blue bonnet field and didn't know what it was, he was determined to find one, including, Joanne might have to fill in some of the story, but he asked the highway patrol that stopped me. No, I wasn't speeding. We had just filled up with gas, and I failed to put the gas cap on. And of course, we looked like, I guess, a bunch of hillbillies moving back from wintering in Texas, because the van was filled. There was barely room for us in there, as well as a canvas thing that we had on top. And according to Joanne, she seems to think that he just stopped us because he seemed to think that we were maybe not doing something we were supposed to have been doing. But when the highway patrol walked up to Lefty's side of the van as I was driving, he rolled down his window, and one of the first things he asked is, "So where's the nearest blue bonnet field that we can?" Anyway, I didn't get a ticket or anything because, good news, we had all the insurance and everything, and he just wanted to tell us that our gas cap was open. And also, I had the benefit of delivering many flowers with Lefty, and he's a great co-pilot. I did not need a GPS.
Hello, my name is Bruce Lundberg, and my folks moved to real close. Okay. So my name is Bruce Lundberg, and we met Lefty and Joanne probably in 1956 or 57. My dad was a superintendent on the Yankton Dam, and they lived in the hotel for, I don't know the exact number of months, 3 to 5, I guess, but at that time, they formed a bond with the Fencils and the Rieses, and it continued on till now. And of course, I think it'll go on further, but I went on several trips with the Ries family. They came up one time, they were gonna go to Shell Lake, Wisconsin, and buy a boat to use on the river. So Lefty, this is probably in the early, say, 63, and we drove to Shell Lake, and they put the boat on the trailer, and there was hauling the boat back to the Twin Cities to drop me off, and I think my sister, but the boat was heavy enough that it was bouncing on the wheels. There was no fenders on the wheels, so they were like, well, we had to stop and try to rearrange the boat on the trailer, which was pretty heavy, but I understand he had the boat for quite a while. But through the years, Lefty would come up and buy Christmas trees, and my brother and I would go with him, and he'd cut the trees, and we'd drag them over to some big pile, and then eventually they'd bring them to down to Sioux Falls, and or Freeman, I should say, and sell those. And that went on about 7 years, and then he started hiring people to bring them in. But it was a great way to bond with the family. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Diane Ellinger, and I am speaking for our daughter Sarah, who couldn't be here today. She loved Lefty very much, as she loves all of the Fencil clan. She worked there many, many summers, learned so much creativity, and saw the kids grow up. I do want to say, though, Mitch, there was one time that Sarah was driving all you kids back from Sioux Falls with, I suppose, a load of flowers. And somebody hit somebody over the head with a bat. I'm not sure, was it Chris that hit Garrett or Garrett hit Mitch or something, but Sarah, Sarah learned a lot from you guys. And, and she loves you all as we all do.
Thank you, everyone, for sharing. Lefty would very much appreciate that. And as Pastor Bob said, thank everyone for coming. It means a lot to the whole family.
I'll be reading John 11, 17 to 27, and 32 to 36. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she told him. "I believe you are the Christ, the Son of God, who would come into the world." When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "See how he loved him."
Thank you, Aaron, for sharing that scripture. Lefty had a lot of your grandchildren fooled that you were his favorite, I can tell that. There are a lot of favorites in there, but that's all right. It's the way it should be. After hearing those testimonies, I kind of wondered, when did he get his work done? He liked to play board games and go fishing and traveling, rather full life. And it reflects now the memories that you have from him, because those were some meaningful experiences for you. You heard the story read from John chapter 11 about the raising of Lazarus. It's one of the familiar texts of the New Testament. I suppose if you made a list of most familiar stories and least familiar stories, Lazarus's story would be rated pretty high on the most familiar. A few chapters later in the book of John, John will speak about Jesus's passion, suffering, and his death and resurrection. And to the careful reader, you will see a connection that this death of Lazarus and Jesus bringing him forth out of the grave was a preamble, a symbol of what was yet to come, when Jesus himself would die and would rise from the dead. Both of these stories speak to the human mortality that you and I all carry. And Jesus has power over that immortality, over our mortality. In life, I don't think I have met any people that, yes, I have, but not many people don't want to live. Most people have a zest for living. We have the comforting assurance that we heard in the text today, and also from other texts, of a promise that there's a place prepared for us. That's good. We like to know that, but we want to live. A Sunday school teacher was asking her young class, "How many of you want to go to heaven?" And they all raised their hand. And there was this one little boy said, "Yes, I want to go, but not now." And that's the story of each of us. We want to go to heaven, but we want to live. And that is obviously the impression that I have that the sisters Lazarus' sisters had about life as well. Yes, they had belief in the future resurrection. They knew that Lazarus would live eventually, but they wanted him alive today. And they tell Jesus a bit of their opinion about his not coming on time. If you had been here sooner, Lazarus would still be alive. We could have avoided all of this. You see, the sisters believed in a future resurrection, like you and I do. But the immediate reality was that their brother was dead. They had good theology, like many of us do. They believed the right things. They believed in the resurrection. It seems that even Jesus is saddened by the event of Lazarus's death. Lazarus was his close friend. And even with this reality that Jesus knew he had the power to call Lazarus forth, we read that Jesus wept. And it gives us an insight to his humanity. I think we need to allow Jesus to be human. He weeps. So easily we think of him as divine, the Son of God, the Almighty, the one in whom divinity resides. And that's fine. We need to hear his words that he is resurrection and life, but we also need to know that he weeps, that he is touched by our grief. Lazarus was a friend of Jesus, and Jesus saw the grief that Mary and Martha had because of the loss of their brother, and he was touched to his heart, and he responded in weeping. It seems as you read the Gospels that Mary and Martha come up quite often, that Jesus visited them quite a bit at their home. Jesus didn't have to wait for an invitation to go to Mary and Martha's house. He was welcome at any time. I'm not sure what kind of board games they played in Jesus's day. I understand Lefty played a few. But I can well imagine that Jesus played checkers or chess or something like that with Lazarus and Mary and Martha. It was a place where he could unwind and refocus. Out in the public, out on the street, Jesus was under constant surveillance. They were trying to catch him and to trap him if they could. But at Mary and Martha's home, the pressure was off. He could relax. And that's the kind of place and that's the kind of relationship that Jesus had with this family. And because of this close fellowship that they had, the sisters didn't hesitate to give Jesus a piece of their mind when he came. They didn't have to keep a happy face in order to keep his friendship. They could risk being honest with Jesus. We expect you to come when we need you. If you had come, if you had shown up, none of this would have happened. Early in the story of this Lazarus story, Jesus said that Lazarus' death was for the glory of God. In this event, God would be honored. Folks, that's wonderful theology, but it's not very comforting to the sisters right now. They have a bit of theology of their own, but that's not what they need right now. You'll notice that Jesus quickly moves from theological discussion to human compassion. The sisters weren't comforted by theology, but they were comforted by a human touch, by someone who knew their infirmities. Jesus wept with them. That's one of the closest relationships and bonds you can ever have, if you learn to weep with someone. Theologians and scholars will use this text to develop what we call doctrines. And that stuff is good for catechism, but it isn't always too practical when people are weeping. You see, this story shows that God is sovereign over death, and that's very comforting. But when death is close to you, you need someone to walk with you, to share the journey and the sorrow with you. Yes, we believe, as Lazarus's sisters did, we believe the resurrection. But when death comes, we want somebody to walk with us when we hurt. This text speaks volumes out of Jesus's humanity. As the book of Hebrews says, that he was moved by our infirmities, and that is demonstrated in the story of Lazarus. One of the last verses of the story says that the raising of Lazarus was not only to bring glory to God, but it was also to bring other people who were present, to bring them to a point of belief in God and to understand God's power, and that Jesus had been sent by God. You see, folks, it's important that we know what we believe, and it's more important to know what that belief is based upon. It's one thing to say you believe in God, but it's something else to say that you believe God's power is fully demonstrated in Jesus Christ, God's only Son. That's focusing your faith to a specific person, one who has power of resurrection. Lefty acknowledged that his hope was anchored in Christ. He knew that God was a God of mercy and of power and of love. Both of those qualities of mercy and power are revealed to us in this Lazarus story. Over the years, Lefty and I shared some enjoyable times together, like the family shared lunch and popcorn, and I didn't get in on too many of the fish, but I was there one day when I think Don caught a catch, and I had a few of those. That's the kind of home it was that I felt welcome in, just like Jesus felt welcome at Lazarus's house. Lefty and I would sit at the flower shop, and we'd watch the world go by, and we would solve a few of its problems, but nobody took our advice. Next time, we would try it again. I felt very at home, very welcome, something like Jesus must have felt in Mary and Martha's home. In the memorial folder, you can see what Lefty's interests and values were. Lefty's last months were difficult, but he remained interested in life. And as one of the grandchildren mentioned, I never knew him to complain or to lament about his situation. It would have been so much easier for Lefty to stay home, but even when the going was tough, he told me about how he went to see a baseball game, and he enjoyed it. I know the family, you put a lot of extra time and work into it. And kudos to you for the way you gave him extra attention and care and took him to these places that were meaningful to him. Just this last summer, Lefty was not having a good day, and the Chislik Fest was really pretty near. And he says, I don't think I'm going to go to the Chislik Fest this year. I could tell he didn't feel well. And you know, the next time I came to visit him, he started telling me what was going on at the Chislik Fest. That's Lefty. He did not give up. He had the desire to continue on in life. But he also was ready to go. It's kind of a yes but not no type situation. In the memorial folder, it mentions that he volunteered for 2 years, I believe it was, in a boys' village in Ohio or Indiana. You can read for yourself. But the interesting point I want to share about that is that Joanne said about 2 months ago, they had received a call from one of the boys that Lefty and Joanne had worked with way back in the 1950s. Folks, that speaks volumes to the effect and the influence you can have on a life. I don't know, if I did my math right, that's 50-some years, maybe 60-some years that happened. And today, there are still memories and fruit from that particular time of volunteering that Lefty and Joanne gave. Speaking about faith came easy for Lefty. When I visited him, that was one of the topics we went to pretty naturally. He enjoyed life, but was ready to move on whenever God called him. And like the psalmist, his hope was in the Lord. One day, on the day that Lefty left us, that's too many lefts in there, but on the day that Lefty died, the family called and told me that he wasn't very well, and I came to visit. I didn't know it then, but Joanne told me that a beautiful red cardinal had shown up just outside their window that morning, and they had not seen a cardinal all year, and you can expand that to ever, she tells me. And there was a cardinal present that morning. I ask you, is that coincidence or is that providence? It was a special omen of something special was going to happen. And for those who stand at the bedside of a dying person, things like that are noticed. Things that are different, you pay attention to. I tried to offer some pastoral words and some words of comfort, but God was way ahead of me. A cardinal had come to share its greeting and the evidence of God's presence. Lefty was silent for a good portion of this time that we were visiting together. Joanne and I were visiting about things that they were and how the night went and that kind of thing. And unexpectedly, after he had been silent for a good long while, he began to speak. And I must have looked puzzled because Joanne told me what he said. I thought he understood it. He said, God is with me. And then, to emphasize it, he looked at me, and now with a stronger voice, he said it again, God is with me. I wonder what Lefty saw or what he felt that prompted those words. We know now that he was passing from this body of death to a new dwelling place with God. A few hours after I had left, I received a call that Lefty's wish had come true. He no longer was with us. A cardinal had appeared, and it seems angels drew near. The psalmist said that the symbol of a rod and a staff comforted him. I ask you, could the presence of a cardinal do the same? Unlike the Sunday school student who didn't want to go to heaven now, Lefty wanted to go now. He expressed that in many times in different ways. I know sometimes I was there and he said, I don't think I'll be here in the morning. Lefty had been looking forward to release from this body. A cardinal visited him. It was just outside his window. And as the memorial folder says, cardinals appear when angels are near. Lefty, we release you into the care of the angels. Thank you, Lord, for a life well lived, for a faith well directed, and for the presence of a cardinal to give us the assurance that you know who we are, where we are, and that we are yours. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Would you now take your hymn book and turn to number 614 in the blue hymnal, and we will sing In the Bulb There Is a Flower. It is very appropriate for somebody who ran a greenhouse. In the bulb there is a flower. Before the benediction, I want to remind you, you are invited to stay for a time of lunch and fellowship with the family. Let us bow our hearts in prayer. Lord, you have made yourself known to us in Christ, and yet at the same time, you are a mystery. We know in the bulb there is a flower, and in the seed an apple tree. In cocoons, a hidden promise that butterflies shall soon be free. All around us is evidence of new life and new resurrection. Everything and everybody awaits its season when we are set free to be what only God can see. And now, to the glory of God the Father, Christ the Son, and the Holy Spirit, who guides us upon this life's path, be praises now and forevermore. Amen.